Yes, thank you, Matti, and welcome to everyone from me as well. It's nice to see quite a range of people and listeners here today, from experienced Firstbeat partners and professionals to what I assume are newcomers to Firstbeat. And in the presentation, I'm going to try to address the topic of supercompensation so that it's applicable to experts, professionals who are looking maybe for coaching tips to use with their own clients, but as importantly to just anyone, regular people who are looking to fine-tune their personal well-being. And of course, us wellness professionals need to look out after our own well-being as well. So the agenda for today, I will do a quick introduction of Firstbeat at first, because some of you are quite new to us. And then I'll dive into the topic of well-being, including what kinds of things constitute well-being. And then I'll introduce Firstbeat Lifestyle Assessment, because I'm using that to visualize stress and recovery in my examples. I'll define supercompensation in its sort of original meaning as it's used in the sports context. And then I'll expand it to regular life, what we call supercompensation of life. I'll also list a few what we call trendy stressors or arguments that we often hear from people in this sphere when they're trying to explain their own well-being. And then I'll have some counter arguments to why these kind of trendy stressors actually are a cause of problems. And I'll conclude with some practical examples of why and how the choices that people make are so important for this supercompensation to be able to happen. But first, a few words about Firstbeat. Our mission is to help individuals reach their health and performance potential with science-backed confidence. Our roots are very firmly in research, and all of our methods are based on the findings that we have come from research. And we are based in Jyväskylä, Finland. Today, we have about 150 people actually working for Firstbeat in Finland, UK, Sweden, Germany, and the US. And we have clients in over 40 countries. And the origins or roots of our methods and what we do today are started from athlete overtraining studies, trying to find a method that would detect overtraining in an athlete before it's too late. And from that, we have expanded the same principles and applied them to regular people, working age people, men and women of all fitness levels and ages. And today we are busy working in these three sectors. So we work with professional athletes in around the world with thousands of athletes and teams in different countries and different sports to help the coach have solutions that improves the performance of their athletes, particularly at team level. So the coach can see what each athlete is doing and can help customize the training program for the needs of each athlete. We also license analytics into almost 100 wearables. So our performance analytics are integrated into wearables so that you can have a device that tells you about your meaningful insights about fitness and lifestyle. And then the professional wellness services is the sector that my examples will mainly be from today. And the idea is to provide a measurement and a method and coaching to help people in different kind of health and wellness projects, health screening and coaching. We have done this assessment to over 200,000 people today around the world. And the principles that Firstbeat uses in all of these three sectors, we are based on measuring heart rate and heart rate variability. So we use some kind of a measurement device that detects every beat of the heart and measures the time between beats and how much this time varies from one beat to the next, which is called heart rate variability, as many of you already know. And we also know that various stressors in life, they cause physiological reactions in the body. And we can use heart rate variability to learn more about these stressors and learn how that affects us. It allows us to look into the sympathetic and parasympathetic part of the nervous system, and then that shows how the body is responding to different stressors in life, or how it's, for example, recovering during sleep. And the key, sort of the unique part of what Firstbeat does is that we convert this heart rate variability data into practical, concrete, personal insights about the effects of stress and recovery and physical activity. So the idea is to combine real life actions with data and then learn from that so that we could learn to make better choices and some permanent changes. a little step backwards, just to look at the building blocks of well-being in general level. This pie here has divided well-being into different topics. And the topic here, the biggest piece of the pie, this 40% segment, what is called lifestyle choices. That's the most important part of well-being. And it's also the part that we can concretely, as individuals, we can affect that by different choices that we make. And today's focus will be solidly on this 40% piece of the pie, the lifestyle factors that we can do. Of course, the other factors are also very important, and many of you are working on that, for example, healthcare sector or how to make healthier environments. But for the individual clients and the individual end users and consumers and people, the choices that they can make in their own life is what matters the most. So then Firstbeat lifestyle assessment that has already been mentioned before. So just so that everyone can kind of be on the same page of what that is. So because I'm going to visualize my message with the lifestyle assessment examples. So what lifestyle assessment is, it's a 3-day 24/7 heart rate variability measurement that's done in the person's real life. People wear a device that detects their heartbeat throughout the 3-day period. And then the assessment result will look at stress management, the balance between stress and recovery, and exercise as sort of important cornerstones of a healthy lifestyle. This is an example of the report that might come out of that. And before we can really talk about supercompensation and what that means, we should understand what stress and recovery mean. So in this context, here is examples of two 24-hour graphs from the Firstbeat lifestyle assessment. And in this context, the red color that you see here, that means stress or activation level of the body, whereas the green color means recovery or slowing down of the body's functions. And both are completely normal and healthy physiological functions. We expect to see them both, and we don't need to try to eliminate the stress from our lives by any means. But if we are too busy, or if the overall load that we experience in life, from training, from job, from family needs, all the different needs that we have, if the load is too heavy and we don't recover enough, then sleep doesn't just happen. If we have too much of this so-called negative stress, it keeps our bodies active and busy and sort of sympathetically driven all day, but it can continue all night as well, or pretty much all night. Like in this bottom example, you can see that even when the person has gone to sleep, they might be asleep, but the quality of their recovery is not good. Their body is not getting the kind of recovery it should be getting because the negative stress keeps going. It sort of keeps the engine ticking even while the person is sleeping. Whereas the top example, the daytime looks pretty similar. You can see a lot of red color. But if it's mainly positive stress that we must have in life in order to be able to perform and rise to different challenges, then usually that kind of stress, it makes us perform better, but we can also turn it off quickly when the stress is over. So for example, in the evening, when this person begins to read and gets ready to go to sleep, you can see the stress level is getting lower, heart rate is slowing down, and the green color starts to happen, and then they get a very good green recovery during night. So the idea between positive and negative stress and the balance between stress and recovery is always to try to find this right kind of balance between them rather than try to eliminate one or the other. And then if you actually look at supercompensation, so to understand, and when people are looking for finding this optimal balance between load and recovery, the principle of supercompensation really illustrates that well. It comes from sports, and basically supercompensation means the improvement in performance that occurs after exercise during sufficient recovery. The graph that you can see here at the bottom, here on the y-axis is performance, and the x-axis is time, and some kind of starting level when an athlete does an exercise session or a hard workout, their performance temporarily decreases due to the training session. Lactic acid builds in the muscle and there is some energy deficit in the body, and that's completely normal. It has to happen. But then during the recovery, when the athlete is sleeping or taking a rest day and recovery, easier workouts, that's when the performance starts to increase. And if the recovery period is sufficient, of good quality and long enough, then actually this supercompensation happens, meaning that they're able to elevate their performance level to a higher level than before. And for this to happen, there has to be correct timing of the training stimulus and recovery, but also, of course, correct dosage of the intensity of the training. So if you do the harder intensity training that you do, the longer the requirement for recovery after that is. And any one of you who is involved in sports coaching or training athletes knows that finding this balance, it's one of the hardest tasks that we will ever have, because to improve performance, we have to train continually harder and harder. We really do have to push the comfort zones and train harder than before. But at the same time, it can't be too hard. It is too hard if we are not able to recover from that. So this is the challenge for coaches, obviously, is to find this right balance between the right amount of load and sufficient time of recovery. Today, there is many technological solutions that can help with that. For example, many of the consumer devices that many of you are surely using, they have things like recovery time. So if you do a high intensity training session, your device might tell you that to really recover from that, you require 24 hours or 48 hours of recovery or easy training. So that can make it easier to find this balance. But the basic blocks of supercompensation are quite simple. Just a second, let me see if I can change the slide. Yeah. So the basic pillars of supercompensation are training, the training stimulus, training load, different kind of workouts that you do, rest, and of course we need fuel. We need the right kind of fuel for the body. So good nutrition is a fundamental piece of this equation. And the job of the coach is to find the right balance between these things so that it actually works. Then when we talk about supercompensation of life, which is when we go from the world of athletes and sports to the life of regular people, again, we still require some kind of load because we all have some kind of load in our lives. It usually includes some kind of training. If you're a corporate athlete or a fairly serious fitness enthusiast, there might be a lot of training in your life. But in addition to that, there is also going to be the demands of job, the demands of your spouse, your kids, hobbies, your overall health situation, your daily commute, all the things that belong to our life, they sort of determine the load of life that we have to find the right balance between the load of life and then the right amount of recovery from that. This example is from the Firstbeat Lifestyle Assessment, this so-called body resources. And the idea here is that the more stress that we have in our lives, the more different kind of stress factors and load we have in our lives, the bigger the demand of recovery is also. But if they are balanced right, even if the resource line comes down during the day, like it does here, pretty much on all three of the days, you can see the graph dropping down. But if the recovery is sufficient, this line should be climbing up to a higher level than where it started from. And this allows us to reach our goals and improve our performance in life and in sport and sort of be the best versions of ourselves. Instead, if we don't make that happen, if we don't have a balance between these things, for example, if we don't sleep enough or we have too much stress and too much load in our lives, then we can see this kind of a situation happening where the resources keep going down all day. And then even during sleep, if the body stays wired, we are sort of running on empty or running out of gas. Most of us sometimes have days like that, that belongs to life. But if that happens day after day and week after week, then what can easily happen is that at some point we run out of gas and it can lead to physical illnesses, catching colds, getting a fever, more serious illnesses, of course, as well, and also mental illnesses, burnout, exhaustion, things like that. So it is really important for everyone to try to find this balance between the right amount of load and right amount of recovery. And I'll try to share a few ideas to what makes it a little bit easier to find that right kind of balance. So I mentioned in the beginning this kind of trendy stressors. And these are the kind of arguments that we who work in the wellness sector often might hear. And then we need to try to find solutions and answers to them to get people to understand that this may not be a sustainable way of thinking. Surely you have all heard this, people who say that I don't need much sleep, I can manage with 5 hours of sleep or 4 hours or 6 hours. But the fact from sleep research and sleep experts supports very strongly that this is a case only for extremely few individuals, that most of us need somewhere between 7 and 8 hours of sleep to really be able to charge our batteries. For how long and at what quality can you survive with 5 hours is a good question. Another one that comes out with people who are into fitness and sport is, when I exercise, I really like to go all out. That it's not real exercise unless you feel the lactic acid burning in your muscles and you really push yourself hard and maybe taste a little bit of blood taste in your mouth, like we say here in Finland. But the question is that, is your fitness actually improving? Because even elite, or especially elite athletes, if they train too hard, too often, their performance is not going to improve. And athletes usually already know that, but it's the normal people, the people who try to train hard in addition to their jobs, that often they try to maximize the benefits of exercise and pushing really hard all the time, whereas instead they should learn to balance easy and hard workouts. Alcohol is, of course, a matter that comes up quite often. People think that beer is a good recovery drink, or a few glasses of wine belongs to a good meal. But our data shows quite strongly that alcohol is one of the biggest challengers for this supercompensation to happen, because it really challenges your recovery. And then I don't have time. Oftentimes people are so busy that they feel like they know they should sleep more or they should exercise, but they don't have time for that. And this is where priorities really come to play, to try to put, for example, sleep on the top of the priority list instead of at the bottom of it, so that you sleep 8 hours if you only have time to do that. The fact is, if you don't have time for wellness right now, you need to have time to be sick later, because statistics and research shows very, very strong correlations between poor fitness, insufficient amount of sleep, high levels of stress, and all different kinds of illnesses. And what I mean with this 24-hour sort of pie here, if you think that most of us work somewhere around 8 hours, maybe in some countries it's more common to work 10 hours or even 12 hours, hopefully we sleep about 8 hours, but then we have about 8 hours left where we can decide how we spend that time. Of course, it usually involves some house chores and some going shopping and taking care of our children, but surely there is also many hours when it's up to us to decide what we are going to do during that time. That's the time when we have usually the biggest amount of influence on what we can do with that, to make sure that there are those kind of good choices that support good sleep and also support good performance. This slide here shows a little bit about the different kind of stressors and how big effect they have on our recovery. So I've divided it from sort of a slight effect on recovery, a moderate effect, or a very heavy effect on recovery. And there are many different things here at the bottom, if you look at them. There's alcohol, some health-related issues, stimulants, lifestyle factors. Some are factors that we cannot affect. So for example, if we have some health concerns or some health issues, if we are working shift work, we have to travel a lot for work. So obviously we can't affect those too much. But then there are many things that are a matter of choice. We can decide ourselves how we are going to deal with that. The one thing that is really good to remember with this one is that the bigger the load or the training volume, the load of life or the stress or the training volume, the bigger the demands on recovery are as well. So it definitely, as our load increases, at the same time increases the need for recovery instead of then skimping on sleep. I'll lift a couple of things from this one that come up a lot. One is alcohol. You can see here that on the so-called slight load, there is a couple of units of alcohol. Typically what we see with one or two units, it delays the recovery by a little bit, maybe 1 or 2 hours of not such good quality sleep before you start recovering. But then as the amount of alcohol increases, the effect on sleep is much bigger. Our database shows this very clearly, that there is a dose-response relationship. The more you drink, the bigger the effect on recovery. And obviously, when trying to balance this supercompensation of life, it's of huge importance to factor this in and to see how many days a week are you compromising your recovery by having maybe multiple drinks. exercise is another thing that's very good to understand with that, because we know clearly, and also a picture of that, that people who are in good fitness, they also have a better ability to recover. But at the same time, acutely, exercise does worsen our recovery. So for example, if you do a high intensity exercise session in the evening within a few hours of bedtime, almost for sure, if you are wearing some kind of a monitor that monitors your sleep, you're going to notice that your sleep quality it's not good that night. That's physiologically very normal, and I wouldn't worry about it, because it's even if an athlete does a late evening football match, for example, their sleep is not going to be very good that night. But over the course of the week, that's fine as long as you don't do it every night. But it's good to remember that when you're planning your training program, that if you do have those high intensity evening exercise sessions, then also plan days off or evenings when you don't do high intensity exercise. So exercise clearly helps us handle stress and recover better as long as we don't overdo that. So then on our way to supercompensation, we need to keep these basic pillars of wellness in place. So we have load and the balance between load and recovery, sufficient sleep, and then healthy nutrition are sort of the key blocks that we have to keep in mind. And then this comes back to making good choices, that the trying to identify what are the things that each one of us can affect in our lives by making better choices. And a couple of examples of that. I referred to this already, fitness. It's a choice. We can all choose to improve our fitness in some way. If it's at a very low level, it's very easy. We can start by integrating a little bit of exercise into our lives. If we are already very, very fit, we probably need some very high-tech coaching and solutions to make sure that we are still able to improve a little bit more. But when we look at the large database of people and look at the balance between recovery and stress, we very clearly see this trend that as the fitness level improves, so also people have more minutes of recovery while they are sleeping and also during the daytime. So the fit people are able to handle the stress better and then get better recovery over the course of 24 hours. And in addition to that, their subjective feeling is also better. So when they were asked how energetic they are feeling during the day, the people in higher fitness level have a better energy level. So it's a great, great investment in overall well-being as well when we invest in fitness. And then this slide shows a couple of other choices that we can make. Life happens. What I mean with that is, like I showed before, that there is most of our days tend to be quite busy, and the red color, some kind of stress, is pretty much normal and routine in our days. And we also have other factors of life that belong to that. Each of these persons had some kind of house chores that they had to do in the evening. But the person on top made a few very good choices after their workday. They went and took a walk in the forest, so they did some kind of nice light physical activity that helped probably sort of balance off the stress of the workday and get them recover towards the evening. They also did a meditation activity in the evening and some reading before bed, and they had a very good restorative effect of sleep. So in this leisure time between work and sleep, they were able to integrate good lifestyle habits that clearly supported their ability to get good sleep. Whereas the guy at the bottom more or less kept going the same way after their workday. They played computer games, they did some emails, maybe work emails that kept their mind very engaged to work as well. And then they finished the day by doing an hour of house chores. You can see that heart rate is getting higher and their stress levels are getting higher right before bedtime. And then it took them several hours before they really began to recover properly. So these are the kinds of things that when we do lifestyle coaching, we bring up these kinds of practical, concrete issues from people's lives, how they could integrate good habits into their days. And this is another slide that many of you have seen before, this green moment slide, things that you can do that help you recover. Conscious mind-body kind of strategies and recovery activities. And we all should try to find something that works for us, whether it's a quick power nap after work, whether it's a massage, reading before bed, mind-body activities like deep breathing exercise or meditation can be very powerful, and they can help us very quickly even if we are in a very stressful situation, we can teach our body to turn from stress to recovery quite quickly if we become good in these kind of methods. But all of us can probably find something that works for us, whether it's done during the workday or in the hours after work and before bedtime. That takes some planning and thinking for most of us, but it's probably one of the better investments in our own well-being that we can do. And before I go to the final slide, just a quick sort of a checklist that when whether you're doing this with your client, if you are a coach and you're doing this with your clients, or you're looking for some personal insights, of course, before starting to make big changes in life, it's good to kind of go through a checklist of your current situation. What are your current realities and limits? And be aware of what are your needs for recovery. Are there some major stressors that you can't change right now? But then in addition to that, try to identify what are the things that you can change and affect. What's your nutrition situation like, your exercise situation, how many stimulants are you taking? Could coffee maybe be one of the reasons that you are staying awake at night? Those kinds of checklists are, it's a good idea to do that at first. Try to go to your things that are important for you and then start fitting in those good lifestyle choices into your days. So I'll finish with this slide that I showed before. Are you super compensating? Are you charging your batteries after busy days with enough sleep and good enough recovery? Or are you sort of running on empty or running out of gas where your resource line is dropping instead of climbing after that? Data can really help visualize this. So in that way, if you have a chance to do some kind of measurements, if you're interested in testing the lifestyle assessment, you can contact us here at Firstbeat, or if you already have access to that, it's a really good way to show things from your life that you might not be aware of. Wearables have those kind of solutions too. But the main thing, I find data is super helpful and really provides some good insights, but we all do need to learn to know ourselves as well, because there are no obvious answers that work for everyone. We are all different individuals, and we have to find our own tweaks and on our own personal need for sleep and recovery. So it takes a bit of experimenting to find that for sure, but we all have it in us. And I guess that's my sort of final message, is that this is a good area to explore, and with the help of data, hopefully learn a few more interesting things about